Let me say this to many of us who see people who are trying to analyze some things about ministers of God. Logical blunder. You cannot use logic to explain spiritual.
Hello, everyone. This is Daniel, and welcome to the first episode of the show. And for more information, follow me on Twitter and Instagram, and join the conversation on Discord for source links and further reading. And most importantly, follow me on Twitter, because that's where we push hashtags. It is the only way to change the world. Instagram is the place for inspiration, to get something, to know something. But to actually change the world and get conversations going, Twitter is the place. What you just heard Johnson Suleiman say isn't a problem. Well, religion isn't the only thing. Teaching people not to ask questions and use their head. Religion is not the only thing telling you to bow to authorities and respect them no matter their deeds, no matter their actions. If you can see through religion, you've got it made. Like, it's a very big start. And if you can actually question things, ask questions to the point where you can say you are not so sure about this thing, about what you believe anymore, and you want to know more, you want to find out. A lot of people believe in God, actually don't know how waters are formed. They have no idea about how seasons are formed, whether it is the earth revolving around the sun or the sun revolving around the earth. They just believe it, no questions asked. So if you can question things to the point that you now know all of these arose from a natural process and not just some spooky supernatural power, then you've got it made. It's a very big start. Like most of us are raised in religion and we think that's all there is, making it seems like disbelief and unbelief is not an option, and we live in that kind of ignorance, a kind of ignorance where you're afraid of everything. You think you're born guilty before you walked out of your father's or your parents' wombs. So if you can question things to this point, you've got it really made. Religion is just a sort of thing they knock into your head before you're seven. And it forges the rest of your life. And you know, when you actually tell children, unquestionable, you are Lord. And that's what it results to. And Justice Suleiman is just a victim of the same system. He's in that he actually knew better. Of course, he knows better in some areas and he lies a lot. But he's just a victim of the same system you and I were born into. It wasn't like I actually chose, you know, to believe what he believes. It was made to believe. No one chooses what to believe. It is just an imposition of what it seems to be the evidence to them. And your belief shifts in accordance to how you understand or how you view the evidence before you. We see the same things. We both see the same sky. But what that really means to all of us is different. Which brings me to the first episode of the show. I'll be talking about fatalism, the acceptance of ignorance, and science, the hope falls off. Fatalism means lethargy and despondency, the learned helplessness, and the acceptance of ignorance is the only solution, opening your mind to the possibility that you do not know it all, and science, the only key to uniting Nigeria, and the only 2+2=4, no matter where you see it, no matter, even if you're looking like from India, or you're looking from Brazil, or Mozambique, it's all the same. 2+2=4. So, in this view, this different view of the world that we all have, different from those in the north or those from Biafrans, this is the place where we find an objective position in our views. We look for objective grounds, lead our lives on what we can both agree on, what can be proven to be true. This is the only solution we have. Welcome to the first episode of the show. Thanks for joining me. So the first thing I want to talk about is why it's not just religion. Before I started this podcast, I want to tell you my story. Before I started this podcast, a brief story. I messaged a lot of people, a lot of atheists, a lot of people, unbelievers, you know, who knew better, who knew that we need to find solutions to our problems and not just travel out of the country. A lot of them said no. A lot of them said, I'm not being respectful or all Nigeria is beyond fixing. I don't think you think that. Of course you don't. Nigeria isn't beyond fixing. The The reason why it is not being fixed right now is because they don't want to fix it or are just lethargic about it. They have no desire to actually fix it or they just concerned about their individual progress. Of course, I've been through hardship and I feel like I should be concerned about myself. Even this podcast itself, I should have been concerned more about myself if I was actually going to look towards my own individual progress and not just group progress. But this is one of the problems. Everyone just wants to make it on their own. They want to focus on their own life while abandoning others. But it doesn't work that way. Everyone has to lift each other up. No one rises on their own. No one is self-made. It is always someone. It's always someone somewhere who sacrifices a little. Each and every single day. The everyday individual who sacrifices a little to get everyone up. That's how we grow up. That's why communism in China is working. I'm not a communist. I just think there are a lot of positive and negative aspects of communism, and communism can lead to fascism in just an instant or despotic rule. But I think that is the main focus. The main focus of communism is to get everyone up. And this is something we have to emulate in a capitalist system. So is Nigeria beyond fixing? I think you have to decide for yourself after listening to the podcast. The only hope for us all, the only hope is an objective grant, an objective worldview. Let me quote a little bit of the Bible for you. Amos 3:3, can two work together unless they agree? Of course, you know, a lot of things are in the Bible that are wrong, a lot of myths and superstitions. But myths doesn't have to be necessarily true before they can have truth in them. Like, something might be a lie, but can possess its own truth. If you read a lot of things about the myths, Greek mythologies, I think you would find truth in them also. About Poseidon, about Thor, about Ares, about the god of thunder and all of those gods that found themselves at the scrapbook of history. Like Thursday is actually named after Thor, you know. And you find a lot of truth, a lot of things. You might not, you won't believe any of it, but you find a lot of truths in them. You don't have to worship the same God to work with someone. Just think about it. Pogba is a Muslim and he has Christian teammates or some atheists among them. But still, they work together. But just imagine if Pogba stops believing that he is a Man U player today. If he starts believing that he's a Man United player, everything would fall apart. He would be replaced and bestowed to some other teams he actually believed in his head. He has the belief in his head, he actually belongs to them. He would be bestowed to them or somewhere else, you know, just to punish him. Although it is not a talk for now, I'll be talking about the bullshit, the kind of lies, you know, the kind of lies that unite humans. Of course, people think, even atheists think, they don't believe something that isn't a lie. We all believe something that is a lie. But once you understand it's a lie, you don't have to. You recognize it for what it is. Like, corporations are a lie. Money is a lie. Money has no value. Money has no worth. And it unites us. It unites the world. Even Osama Bin Laden, with his hatred for the American government and their society and their religion, he spends US dollars. He loves US dollars. He loved it before he died. So when religion isn't the problem, and the money isn't the problem, it's something else. It is culture. The only thing that unites us all, culture is the only thing. The only thing that differentiates society from society, from another society. So if we can fix that, if we can get that fixed, we got it made. What would be won't be, folks? A lot of people say stuff like that. Atheists say it, unbelievers say it, and the Christian says it, they say it a lot. It's something we have in common with Italians. I wrote an article about it on my website, so you guys check it out. I will link it in the description, so you guys go check it out. Something that is the downfall of the Roman Empire and what is causing regress in the Italian society up to this moment. First, let's talk about it in scientific terms. Action creates reaction. Without action, there can't be a reaction. So for tomorrow to be good, or something to work out tomorrow, there has to be action today. That's just it. Fatalism is one of the first attributes you see in the lives of unproductive people. When people give up, when they believe their fate is no longer in their hands and the future is no longer in their hands and it's controlled by some external force outside of them, they become despondent, they become redundant. It is just like believing you have no free will, that something couldn't have happened in any other way around. So you let go of your life and your life goes into free fall. One of my heroes says something. He said, a society oriented towards fatalism, or one in which an interventionist deity forms part of the matrix of causal connections, is bound to produce fewer individuals inclined to probe the unknown with the tools of science. Fatalism, which brings me to the idea of destiny. Like the future, people say destiny and your destiny has been predetermined and everything, accordingly, you know the way they say it. Everything has been written before you were born. A lot of Muslims believe it, this idea. A lot of Christians believe it. Like everything that you experience in your life has been written and preordained by the one who created you, by your creator. But this isn't an idea that came from the mind of successful people. Like successful people knows they worked to get to the position they are in that present moment. But I think, in my opinion, it is a sort of refuge in the minds of those who failed in their life, those whose life turned out in a way they never expected, or in a way they think they do not deserve. So they say it was preordained, it was pre-written. It is just a form of story. It's a form of refuge in the art of failures. I think it's a form of refuge in the art of failures to accommodate their failure so they can live with it. So what will be for lazy people, and destiny and fate for those who failed. Like if Ronaldo or a boxer would actually talk about their victory, they say, I worked really hard. They say, I worked really hard. I trained 24/7 every single day. I changed my diet. I watched my weight. I watched everything I do. And I got this. But I remember when Mikel, during the Nations League, he said something that it couldn't have happened any other way around. It wasn't meant to be. That is something you hear in the mouth of failures. I don't mean Mikel is a failure. I just say when they actually fail, when they cease to not meet the expectation, you hear something like, it wasn't meant to be. But when you win, wow, I worked hard. Just be consistent a little bit. And what's wrong with this boxer? Just think about it. What is wrong with these boxers that thank God every time they win? As in, when they win, they thank God. And when they lose, they just say, I did something wrong. God isn't to be praised. Well, thank him for the failure, thank him for the success. I don't know. Like, God in his busy time came to attend to you. No, that's actually kind of lame in my idea. But they say it. So to be able at any moment in your life to change something, you have to believe it's always in your control. Vitalism, like the idea of prayer, and not just prayer, the idea of expectation is actually based on the belief that you can't do this something yourself. Just think about it. When you pray to God for something, you are admitting that you can't get something done. It's the basic idea that you can't get something done, that it is not within your power. No matter how little you actually pray or request for expectation for something from someone else, the fundamental idea is that you can't do it for yourself. And the basics, the foundation for achieving anything, to getting anything done, is believing that you can do it. And no matter how little, people say, my faith teaches me to work, and it is work and pray, and stuff like that. But no matter how little the inch, that you believe it is not in your power and you need to pray, it's a problem, and it is opening your career and your goals to failure. Just think about if there isn't a God out there, if there is no one there who cares about what you do when you are asleep or when you have sex with someone else, or what you do when you're naked, just think about it. Do you really have that luxury? Do they have the luxury of believing someone is out there who cares for them and they can sleep safe and sound in their couch and their bed because someone is out there watching out when no one is? Do you actually have that luxury of believing in falsehoods and not verifying your claims and living your life in a fatalistic manner and why, and you think what will be, and someone is out there working in your favor. And that is one of the roles religion plays in our culture. And just think about for a moment why Japanese value honor. No, corruption isn't caused. Corruption is not caused by religion. Just think about it. If you say you should take away religion, would people stop embezzling money? Would politicians stop embezzling money? Would SARS and the police and the soldiers stop harassing people? It is culture, not religion. It is not the taking away of religion that will solve these things. It is actually the fixing of culture. The Japanese culture values honor. The value honor, it is like up to now. In the past, what they do is, like, samurais actually sacrifice their life for their general. They remain loyal to the end. Like, even if they know you are a bad person, of course, Bushido is a very bad thing in some way. But just look at the basic foundation. Bushido is the act of alignment with your Ronin, or I think the samurai, your leader. And, okay, Oyabushi, your leader. They call Oyabushi your leader, no matter, like, I think in the military and the samurai code, you stay loyal to the end. And up until now, Japanese have no one to be loyal to when it comes to military and paramilitary alignment. What they do now is they are loyal to their company. Like, they will work to the end. Nigerians don't care about 9 to 5 or 9 to 6. They will stay loyal. Japanese will stay loyal to the end. Like, they know that working for your company, it's what working well for your company is what build the economy. They know working for your company is what builds the economy, and they're not doing it for themselves. They're doing it for their country, and they're doing it for their society, for everyone to be able to have equal share in the cake of the society. But in Nigeria, no one cares about the progress First Bank is making, or the progress Dangote is making, or the taxes it is paying to. And this is not something we should actually look lightly upon. It shouldn't be taken with the key down at all. You know, loyalty actually works, and honor. Nigerians do not value honor. If all those politicians actually value honor, they won't be saying something like, I'll be killing my fellow Nigerian for the sake of some Arab man that died many years ago for the sins of the Arab, or whatever he did. If the value honor, like the ability to stand before the world and say, I did this myself, I achieved all this myself. And it is not religion that will actually teach you all this. Like, a lot of atheists and unbelievers are not honorable. Like, of course, a few of them are, like, they are very few compared to the religious ideologies and all other people worshipping some sort of metaphysical or superhuman who they think govern their lives and their actions, and they should live their life according to a book. But no, Nigeria still has a long way to go when it comes to talking about honor and acting it out. These politicians are not honorable men. But in Japan, with the desire, the will to stand before the world, that you achieved something yourself, you achieved something great yourself, it is a big pride. And it is the core value. Like, Japanese are now seriously loyal. In fact, they're actually committing. Just think about Kurashi, or I think it's Kurashi, what they call it in Japanese culture. You stay loyal to your company. You work till you die. It is not for the company, because the company will end up paying taxes. It is for your country. But Nigerians do not care about that. That isn't religion. That is culture. The culture that teaches you to cut and run. And entomowe lumowe. That is not religion. That is culture. And now we think we know it all. In the past, when the Chinese and the British and the Europeans were exploring the world, when they were exploring the reward, they thought they knew it all. Like, it was the first person. The first person to actually decide they do not know it all. The maps, just go look, go online and look at the old maps of the European empires. It is filled with horrors, in like monsters and demons. When it comes to the parts of the world they've never explored, they feel the parts. But the first country in the world, the first country to ever accept their ignorance and that they do not know it all, was Britain. And you know, they owned almost, I think they owned the biggest empire the world has ever known. The British owned the biggest empire the world has ever known. When the Arabs, they were Muslims, they thought they know it all, they knew it all also. When they went to India, they didn't think about learning their language, they didn't think about they just went there about learning their culture or testing their soils. But when the British went there, they went there with test tubes, they went there with scientific equipment, and they realized they do not know it all. The first country in the world to draw empty maps was Britain. They accepted their ignorance. Of course, religion actually plays a role in this, but still it is the culture. A lot of people, like your dad, just think about the difference between a poor man and a rich man. Of course, no. Of course, ignorant people are always poor. The difference between a rich man and a poor man. A poor man will tell you, obey authorities, just listen to them, listen to whatever they tell you. But a rich man will say, use those people, ask them questions. I don't mean exploit others, just ask questions. And that represents hope. You can correct the dentist. When it comes to a rich man, he will tell you to ask questions. Always ask questions. But the poor man will say, listen to the lawyer. What do you know? They know more than you do. And who do you think will actually fare well in years to come between someone that asks questions or someone who thinks they know it all? Acceptance of ignorance. I'll be talking more about this when it comes to how empires are built and how they are lasting. I'll be talking about this. And the last thing is science. The only thing, the only worldview compatible with the unification of the whole world. The unification of the world. We have to build a global society. A global society that prides itself on reason. Because every single thing, like money can't buy honor. If you go to Japan and you say you want to bribe a politician, you end up in jail. Like, money can actually penetrate something like that. Of course, a lot of people actually sell their honor because of money. Parents can actually sell their child for money and stuff like that. But still, when it comes to it, all about what it means to me and what it means to you. Money can't buy honor in Japan. But reason is the only thing. The only thing that can unify the whole of Nigeria is reason. If we pride ourselves on reason and holding nothing to be above questioning and nothing to be above being held to accountability, we can make progress. Just in case this episode is draggy, I want to tell you guys that next episode, I'll be talking about beliefs, about the kind of different beliefs that unite us all: religion, corporations, imperials, money, values, and honor. Thanks for joining me on this podcast. Thanks for your attention. Join the conversation on Discord. Follow me on Instagram and Twitter. And I think I'll be investigating, like making some field work soon enough. So stick around. Have a great day, guys.